This is the day the Lord has made. Let us be glad and rejoice. The presence of the entire Filipino nation, as well as that of the rest of the world, are greatly felt here today, in this very place where the story of Christianity first began some 500 years ago, on April 14 of 1521. The Archdiocese of Cebu welcomes all of you, our live feed viewers, to the commemoration of the first baptism in this part of the land, in this part of the world, that brought us, that planted for us, the seed of the Christian faith. We give our warmest welcome to all the elderly joining us today on our live broadcast. We want to thank you for your Christian witnessing and for your efforts in nurturing this present generation in the same Christian faith. Our warmest fraternal hugs also goes to the many men and women of the other Christian churches, particularly the Reformed and Evangelical churches that have flourished in this land over the many years. With us, we share in the one confession of the Christian faith, and certainly with us, we will be united in our efforts to translate the message of Christianity into concrete works of love in the service of the poor, the forgotten, the lonely, the elderly, the sick, the unloved, and the abandoned. Today, we mark the fourth and final day of our launching event in celebration of the 500 years of Christianity with the commemoration of the first baptism. We will be featuring... We will highlight today three special features. The first, at 2 p.m., we will see the artistic rendition or reenactment of the baptism of King Carlos and Queen Juana of Cebu. And then at 4 o'clock, we will have our official liturgical Thanksgiving celebration with the celebration of the Eucharist to be presided over by no less than the head of the diplomatic mission of the Holy See to the Philippines in the person of the Apostolic Nuncio, Archbishop Charles Brown. And with him are the bishops of the region, headed by our very own Archbishop Jose S. Palma, the Archbishop of Cebu, and representatives of the local clergy. And finally, tonight at 7:30, we will have the fourth installment of our series of cultural shows. Today we will have the performance of the San Diego dance troupe in a show entitled Credo in Unum Deum. And so, from all of us here in the Queen City of the South, in Cebu, where everything began 500 years ago, welcome and happy quincentennial anniversary to our faith in the land. We hope that you'll be with us in the succeeding hours to join us in this momentous historic events. Maayong hapon sa tanan, mabuhay Filipinas, mabuhay world.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the San Diego Dance Company in the reenactment of the first baptism 500 years ago.
Cebu was not a large city in the ordinary sense of that word. There were no large buildings and none of the churches or temples which adorned the cities of Asia and Europe. But it was obviously a thickly populated area, and it extended over a large portion of the coastline. The houses were made of wood or bamboo, walled and roofed with kogon grass or nipapaw. They were built high above the ground in the Malayan manner, houses on logs, or as a more modern writer has described them, houses on stilts. Thus, it was not a splendor of a city, but the number of houses that amazed the Spaniards as they sailed into the harbor of Cebu. Hundreds of houses lined the shore to form a settlement.
Thank you.
From his flagship, Magellan was impressed by what he saw. Cebu was obviously a large center of population and of trade, and he decided to enter it with ceremony. On sailing up the harbor, he ordered the ships to lower their sails and fling out all their banners. As they dropped the anchor, the ships fired with artillery. It was intended as a friendly gesture, a form of military salute. But naturally enough, it caused consternation among the natives. The Spaniards who went ashore with an interpreter to act as envoy to the local king found him surrounded by a vast crowd of people who had been terrified by the cannonade. But having gotten over their initial fright, the people of Cebu showed themselves far from naive. Magellan and his crew may have been the first white men to come, but they were not the first foreign visitors to Cebu. The people were used to foreign traders carrying porcelain and other goods from China, Annam, Siam, Borneo, and the Malay Peninsula. The Raja of Cebu, accustomed to foreign traders from Asia, was prepared to deal with the Europeans as traders. Raja Humabon, for that was his name, was a man who understood his own dignity. He would not talk directly to the European envoys, but to his subordinate official, who in turn spoke to the foreigners through an interpreter. Speaking in this manner, the Raja asked questions. What was the meaning of the cannonade? What did the strangers want? If friendship and trade, they were welcome. But in that case, it was customary for foreign visitors to pay him tribute. This was a new experience for the proud men from Europe. They probably never dreamed that a tribute would ever be demanded of them by a native ruler. They explained to Raja Humabon that they were subjects of the Emperor Charles, the greatest king on earth, and that they would not pay tribute to any local chief. But they came in peace and friendship, and all they wanted was to barter Spanish goods for native food. They added an undiplomatic ultimatum. If the King of Cebu wanted peace, he could have it. If war, he could have that too. Having the King of Cebu promise to Captain Magellan to become Christian, it was agreed that the ceremony take place on Sunday, April 14. For this purpose was built a platform decorated with tapestries and coconut branches. About 40 of us went down from the ships, all carrying arms, and the royal banner being carried by two men. A volley from the cannons signaled our arrival. The King and the Captain embraced each other and went up the platform where two chairs covered with blue velvet had been placed for the occasion. The natives of higher rank sat down on cushions. and the rest on mats. In the middle of the square, raised a huge cross. And Magellan showed it to all those who wanted to become Christians, telling them to destroy their idols and replace them with a cross. He also taught them how to make the sign of the cross, emphasizing that besides good works, they should follow these acts of devotion. The captain general, who was dressed in white, said that this was the symbol of his love for them. As they heard this, their emotion could be felt, although they said nothing in response. The captain, holding the king by the hand, led him to stand where he received baptism together with his men. He was given the name of Carlos in memory of the emperor. The prince, his brother, was named Fernando, and the king of Limasawa, Juan. One of the Moro traders, Cristobal, and so on with the rest up to about 500. Was already sitting on a cushion and many women of her court on mats around her. While the chaplain was getting ready for the ceremony, I showed her an image of our Lord, a small statue of the child Jesus and a cross. Upon seeing them, she was moved with contrition, and with tears in her eyes, she asked to be baptized. She was administered the sacrament of baptism together with all the women of her court, and given the name of Juana in memory of the mother of the emperor. The wife of the prince was named Catalina, the queen of Limasawa, Isabel, and so was done with the rest of the women. That day, there were about 800 persons baptized, including men, women, and children. The queen asked for the statue of the Holy Child to take the place of her idols, and I gave it to her. Thank you.
Exsules fili.